Hi guys, and welcome to my video editing tutorial series. I'm the creator of the game called Snappy Mouse Run, and in this video I will show you how you can stabilize your shaky videos using Blender and using FFmpeg. Let's do FFmpeg first. If you're not familiar what FFmpeg is, it's a cross-platform command line tool. It has a bunch of video editing features, among others the ability to stabilize shaky videos. If you have FFmpeg installed and ready to use, then this will most likely be the fastest way to stabilize your videos. Like every command line tool, it's probably faster than any other tool with a graphical user interface, and it's perfect to automate things if you know the steps you need to do in advance. The downside is that you cannot see the actual result until FFmpeg has finished processing, and since FFmpeg has a lot of parameters to configure, it can take a while to try them all out in order to see what gives the best results. If you know the parameters in advance, it's a perfect tool. Let's get started. I have FFmpeg already installed on my system, so I will skip the installation process. In order to use it, you need to open a command line or terminal application on your system. Since I don't want to leave Blender, I will use an add-on and convert the Blender Python console into a Bash console. So, by pressing Enter, it will execute as Python command, and if I press F10, it will execute as Bash command. Again, you don't need to use an add-on in Blender like I do. Any terminal application outside Blender is good enough. Okay, I've got two videos in the current directory. Let's play video number one. In order to play it, I have already prepared a play command, which I will copy into the console. As you can see, I'm calling ffplay, which is also from the FFmpeg package and was installed with FFmpeg play. This is the shaky video number one. Let's stabilize it using FFmpeg. In order to do this, we will need to call FFmpeg two times. I will copy the first command into the console. Input video is video number one, and we are calling FFmpeg with the option with step deck. It will calculate the relative translation and rotation transforms of the video and generate a transforms file. By default, it will save the transforms file into the same folder. Now I'll copy the second FFmpeg command. This one calls FFmpeg with the with step transform parameter. By default, it uses the transforms file in the current folder from the previous command and applies the stabilization to the given video, in our case video number one. Also, it is recommended to apply an unsharp filter, which sharpens the video a bit. The stabilized video will be called video one step. Okay, now let's combine the stabilized and the original videos side by side into a single one for comparison. FFmpeg can combine it for us with the following command: execute and play the comparison video. The right one is clearly more stable, so we are done with this one. What I have showed you so far are the default parameters recommended by FFmpeg documentation. However, you can tweak the default behavior, for example by setting the additional bitstop detect shakiness parameter, in order to calculate a more accurate transforms file. If no value is given, the default value of 5 is taken, and according to the documentation, you will get better results for really shaky videos if you set it to a higher value, for instance 10. Or you can adjust the smoothing of the bitstop transform parameter when applying the stabilization. Default value is 10, and it means that in order to stabilize the current frame, it will use 10 frames from the past and 10 frames from the future. Okay, I have another video prepared, video number 2. Let's play it. This one has got this heavy impulse-like shakiness. Let's try to stabilize this one. Same procedure, but this time I will set the previously mentioned shakiness parameter to 10 and also the smoothing to 50. And again, side-by-side comparison. Looks definitely better, but still shaky, especially on the edges. We could tweak the parameters further, but if the original video has this sort of heavy impulse-like shakiness, any kind of stabilization will actually not help you much. This shakiness on the stabilized video that gets worse to the edges is caused by the lens of the camera, the so-called fisheye. The wider the field of the view of the camera, and the heavier the impulses are, the worse will be the stabilization quality. One way of getting a perfect stabilization would be to first correct the lens distortion of the original video and so get rid of the fisheye, and then stabilize it. FFmpeg can also help you to remove the fisheye, but lens distortion is a topic for another video. So these are, in my opinion, the most important FFmpeg parameters for video stabilization. Documentation has a huge list of parameters you can use for all sorts of video processing. You can play around and see what fits your needs. Again, the downside of FFmpeg is that it's really hard to live tweak those parameters, since you always need to wait for the end result before you can make further further adjustments. So that was FFmpeg, a very powerful and pretty straightforward tool. Okay, now let's stabilize the video using Blender itself. Instead of the 3D viewport, we need the movie clip editor. Go to open and navigate to your video. Now let's start with video number one. One problem we see right after opening the video is that the video is somehow rotated. The question is, why is it rotated in Blender and not when we play it? Well, this happens if you take videos with your smartphone in portrait mode, like I did. If we probe the video file using FFProbe in the console, FFProbe is another useful tool from the FFmpeg package, we actually see that the clip is indeed rotated. The width is larger than the height, so Blender is correct at this point. The option that Blender ignores is the so-called rotation flag saved in the stream metadata. The stream is flagged to be rotated 90 degrees, and that's the reason why FFmpeg and my video player show the video correctly oriented. How to fix this? You might think that changing the flag to 0 in the stream metadata would fix the problem in Blender, but again, Blender ignores the flag completely, regardless if it is set or not. Blender reads the stream as it is, in this case 1920x1080. So we can either stabilize the video rotated like this, or re-encode it to 1080x1920, and then stabilize. We will re-encode it first using FFmpeg with the following command. The command just reads the video stream and re-encodes it back to a new file. Okay, but how do we rotate it? Since FFmpeg respects the rotation flag, it will automatically rotate the video, and that's the whole trick. Of course, we don't want to lose any quality while re-encoding, that's why it is recommended to use the preset very slow and CRF around 17 or 18. According to specification, this should give us a visually lossless output. Again, this workaround is only needed if you take shots with your smartphone and Blender does not respect the rotation flag. Open the new video, and now the video is properly oriented. Before we start, let's try to drag the time cursor on the timeline. We see it's really laggy. That's because Blender tries to live render in full size, and we actually don't want that while editing. We can edit in lower quality by defining a proxy. In the numbers panel, check proxy timecode, and 50% quality will be sufficient. So set all to 50% and build proxy timecode. Okay, proxy is done. If we drag the timeline, we see it's a lot smoother and we can start stabilizing the video. As you may have noticed, we have not even started stabilizing in Blender, and there were so many things we had to take into account just after importing the video. Don't get discouraged, you will soon see the full power of Blender. Back to stabilizing. In Blender, the video is stabilized using markers that track some small area of the footage and record the position and rotation of the area on every frame. Once that area gets out of the frame, for instance because we have rotated the camera, we lose the marker and the marker's job is done. The goal is to make every marker stick to its area as long as possible and to avoid losing them. We saw earlier that on this particular video, the camera is doing a panning motion. For instance, if you place a marker on this tree in order to track it, it would quickly get out of the frame. We would lose the marker and we would need to replace it with a new one. Since the camera is panning, we would need to replace markers very often. This may be a good indicator whether we should stabilize this clip using Blender or not. For simplicity's sake, we will make sure that each marker tracks an area that is visible on every frame during the whole clip, so we don't need to worry about losing markers. With that said, we will skip the first video and instead try to stabilize video number two. This one is properly oriented, set proxy and build proxy. On this video, we see that this big portion of the footage is visible on every frame, so the whole area is perfect for tracking. When placing markers, it's important to find some very distinctive parts of the footage so the tracking algorithm can find them more easily. Also, in order to get the best results, markers should track things on the footage that are roughly at the same distance from the camera. The best we can do in this case is to place one here at this notch, control left click, open the track tab in the numbers panel, and here you can see which area gets tracked. I will make the area a bit bigger by scaling, press S to scale, and position the sender right into the notch. Just drag it either on the footage or here in the panel area. Just to make sure we don't lose the marker along the way, go to track settings, set match to previous frame so the tracking algorithm just compares the new frame to the previous one, and under extras, lower the correlation to about 60%. Also, you can set those settings here in the tools panel, so every new marker will have those by default. Now let's make another one here, and just to be sure, place a third one here. To demonstrate why we are setting those parameters, I will increase the correlation to 95% on this marker here and set match back to keyframe. Now select all by pressing A, open track in the tools panel, but before we start tracking, let's do one thing first. Go to the footage tab and under footage settings we can see how many frames the footage has, 302 in our case. So increase the end frame in the timeline to about 500 so we are safe, and make sure that start is set to the first frame. Good. Now under track in the tools panel, press track markers. Okay, we lost one. Select the one we've lost. If you drag on the timeline, we can inspect each marker. The marker tracked until this frame. On the next frame, we've lost it. This can happen if the correlation is set too high, and in our case, it is set to 95%. Let's try to lower it to 85% and maybe make the area a bit bigger so the algorithm has more data to work with. Now repeat the process, but first, lock the other two markers so they are not tracked again. You need to select each one and activate the lock in the numbers panel. Okay, both are locked. Select this one, and from this frame onwards, where we lost the marker, let's clear the tracking information and track again. Now we got this one also. Let's inspect it by looking the area in the numbers panel and dragging on the timeline in order to see the quality. Okay, this one is pretty stable, except for the last frame where it shifted away from the target area. We see that in the numbers panel, and there we will also fix it for this frame. Drag it back where it was. Done. Lock it. Now let's inspect the other two. We see this one is not very stable. It shifts away from the target area. If there are just a few frames off, we can manually correct it for every frame by moving it around. In our case, there are too many frames to correct it by hand. So from this frame onwards, I will clear the tracking information, increase the correlation to 95%, and track again. Inspect it. Okay, the last frame is shifted again. Let's drag it back. Okay, lock this one, inspect the third one. Looks okay. Now go to your numbers panel and select the stabilization tab. Check 2D stabilization and also check rotation, because we want the rotation also to be stable. Now select all the markers by pressing A and add all of them to tracks for location and all to tracks for rotation scale. This means that all the markers will influence location, rotation and scale stabilization quality. Check auto scale and go to clip display and check show stable. Zoom a bit out. Okay, we see Blender has auto scaled the footage, and what will be rendered is this portion of the footage right here. All this area around will be cropped away. If we drag the timeline or press play, we can have a preview of how this will look like. So it is pretty stable. Again, we cannot get around the previously mentioned fisheye lens distortion. It is still present, and in order to get a better stabilization quality, we need to get rid of the fisheye before stabilizing the footage. But apart from this, it's definitely more stable than the original. Now you may say, okay, but all this information will be cropped away. I don't want to lose all of that. And that's where Blender shines at its best. You can customize pretty any aspect of the stabilization. For instance, disable auto scale and scale the footage to about 1.2 so you lose less information. Let's see how this looks like. Now at this point you see that your footage gets out of the frame, no problem. Shift it up on the y-axis, preview again. If you still see that the footage occasionally gets out of the frame, maybe decrease the location or rotation influence of the markers. All these tweaks influence the stabilization of the whole footage. But what if you want to tweak just this one particular part of the footage? For instance, only the end, and leave the rest as it is. You can accomplish this with keyframes. Blender lets you set keyframes on pretty much any setting you want. To see keyframes, open a new panel, divide it, select Graph Editor on the left and Dope Sheet on the right. Now I see here at the end that the footage is shifting too far to the left and out of the frame. I'll go to the first frame where it starts and place a keyframe on the X offset at value 0 by hovering with the mouse over it and pressing I. You should now see the new keyframe in the dope sheet. Now I will fast forward the clip, increase X offset to correct the stabilization, and place another keyframe here on this value. If I now drag the time cursor between those keyframes, you see how X offset is changing between those values. Also in the graph editor, if you disable only selected and press the home key to best fit the curves, you can tweak even the value transitions between the keyframes. So with Blender, you can really control how the stabilization is done and also get instant feedback if what you're doing has the desired outcome. Using FFmpeg, you don't have this luxury. Okay, now let's say we are satisfied with the result and we want to render it. Open the sequencer in the new panel. We want to see the sequencer and the preview. Position the time cursor to the start frame, which is 1 in my case. Now in the sequencer, press Shift A, and under clip you should see your clip. If you're not seeing your clip, then it's a bug. The workaround is to just open a a second clip in the movie editor, switch back to the stabilized one, shift A, clips, and select the stabilized video. Okay, open the numbers panel in the sequencer, press N, and in the strip tab, under video, check stabilize 2D clip, then under time, make sure the strip starts at frame 1, and we see the last frame is 303. So this should also be the start and end frame of our render. This means it will render from frame 1 to frame 303. Also make sure in the movie clip editor under footage that the start frame is set to 1 and offset to 0. Okay, that was the timeline and clip preparation. Now go to the actual render settings in our properties under output. Resolution is okay. Frame rate is very important. It needs to match the original clip frame rate, which is 30 for my clip. Output folder is okay. File format, choose FFmpeg video. Blender also uses FFmpeg internally. Encoding, we want MPEG-4. Video codec is H264. And audio, let's set AAC. Okay, now render and render animation. You can watch the final output as it renders. This can take a while. To conclude, personally, I'm always trying to stabilize video using FFmpeg first, and if I cannot get the desired results, then I go over to Blender and do the stabilization manually. At 9 out of 10, I'm satisfied with the stabilization using FFmpeg. But if I really want to tweak and squeeze the best out of the video, then I would go with Blender, because it just gives you so much control and you can get instant feedback if you're on the right track. On the other hand, if you want to stabilize a video with panning camera motion, you will have a hard time setting all these markers in Blender. Using FFmpeg, you just don't need to worry about those. And that's it for this video. If you want to see more videos like this, please give a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. I really appreciate it, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye!